All stand.
The case you're about to see is a fictional one, but the procedure is legally accurate. The characters are played by actors, but the jury is selected from members of the public.
The prisoner will stand. George Arthur Mitchell, you stand charged on indictment with 5 counts of theft contrary to Section 1 of the Theft Act 1968. The first is that on Sunday, September the 25th, 1977, at Mill House, Parkside Grove, Fulchester, you stole 1 diamond and amethyst ring valued at £700 and 1 silver filigree bracelet valued £300, both being the property of Vivian Cunningham. To that count, how do you plead? Are you guilty or not guilty?
Not guilty.
On the second count, it is charged that on the same date and in the same place, you stole an enamel and gold necklet valued £200, the property of Diane Cunningham. To this count, how do you plead? Are you guilty or not guilty?
Not guilty.
On the third count, it is charged that on the same date and in the same place, you stole a gold-plated cigarette lighter valued £150, the property of Richard Cunningham. To this count, how do you plead? Are you guilty or not guilty?
No, not guilty.
On the fourth count, it is charged that on the same date and in the same place, you did steal a man's cashmere overcoat, valued £200, the property of Douglas Cunningham. To this count, how do you plead? Are you guilty or not guilty?
Guilty.
On the fifth count,
I'm sorry, did you say guilty to that charge, Mr. Mitchell? The one of stealing the cashmere coat?
Yeah, I did.
And on the fifth count, it is charged that again, on the same date and in the same place, you stole 1 imitation garnet ring valued £10. To this count, how do you plead? Are you guilty or not guilty?
Guilty. Guilty.
Thank you. Sit down, Mr. Mitchell, please. Summon the jurors in waiting.
Tell the court in your own words what transpired.
I was proceeding along Station Road, and there's a small corner shop about halfway along it at the junction of Station Road and Broadley Street. As I approached it, the shop door opened and a man came out. He shouted something abusive in the direction of the interior of the shop and then slammed the door shut and started to walk away. I called after the man and asked him if there was any trouble, and if so, whether I could be of assistance to him.
Officer, perhaps before we go any further, can you see that man in court today?
Yes, Your Honour, the accused.
Thank you. Yes, go on then, please.
I asked him if I could be of any assistance to him, and he replied with words to the effect that his opinion of the police force was a somewhat poor one, and he wished me to go away and mind my own business. I said, "That's a smart coat you've got there, sir," referring to the overcoat which he was carrying at the time.
Yes, just a moment again, please, officer. The coat there on the table marked as Exhibit 1 may be held up for the witness to see, please. Is that the coat you're referring to, officer?
Yes, ma'am, or certainly one very like it. I asked him where he'd obtained the overcoat, and he replied that he'd been given it by a friend about half an hour earlier that afternoon. I asked him if he could supply the name and address of the friend who had given it to him, and he said, "Yes, Mrs. Cunningham, Mill House, Parkside Grove, and you can ring her up and ask her if you like." I said, "Is there anything in the pockets of it?" And he replied, "No, like what?" I asked him if he would have any objection to my looking in the pockets, and he said, "No, you cannot, what for?" After a short discussion, he handed the overcoat over to me and said, "All right then, if you don't believe me, go ahead and look." In the pockets of the overcoat were a number of articles of jewellery. I asked him what he was doing with them in his pockets, and he said he knew nothing about it and had no idea how they came to be there. In view of his demeanour and the nature of the articles...
Yes, just a moment, officer. The articles which were in the coat pockets, are they the ones also on the table there? Exhibit 2, a diamond and amethyst ring, Exhibit 3, a silver filigree bracelet. Exhibit 4, an enamel and gold necklet. Exhibit 5, a gold-plated cigarette lighter. And Exhibit 6, an imitation garnet ring.
Yes, ma'am. I asked him if he would accompany me to the police station in order to make a statement about how the articles came into his possession.
Thank you, officer.
Do you wish to cross-examine this witness, Mr. Bendrahieri?
Oh, if Your Honour pleases, yes, sir.
Well, it's if you please, Mr. Bendrahieri.
Officer, is Station Road normally part of your beat?
It comes within my beat when I'm in that area on my beat, yes.
When was the last time you'd been along it?
On the day in question, do you mean? Well, I'd only been on duty
No, ever, hours. Whenever it might have been. Beforehand, at some other time?
Sorry, I don't recall. I can't remember.
Some considerable time before? Weeks, maybe months even, perhaps?
Yes. Yes, it could have been, I suppose, perhaps.
You see, what it is I'm suggesting to you, officer, is that Station Road is not by any means well known as a troublesome place. So, was there a particular reason for you to be in Station Road at 3 o'clock on this particular Sunday afternoon?
I was in Station Road at 3 p.m. on that particular Sunday afternoon because it was my responsibility as beat patrolling officer to be on my beat and patrolling some or other part of it at all times during my shift of duty.
Is it your answer, please, that there was no particular reason for you to be in that particular place at that particular time on that particular day?
Yes, that is
Thank
correct.
Thank you. Officer, I have over here a copy of an extract from the occurrence book of Cannon Close Police Station for the afternoon, Sunday, September 25th, last year. It records that at 2:58 p.m., an anonymous telephone call was received from a coin box stating that a number of men were behaving suspiciously in Station Road. That message was passed on by radio to the beat patrol officer, who was, of course, yourself. Do you remember receiving that call on your radio?
Yes, no, you come to mention it, I do. To be quite honest, it slipped my memory that it was on the same day.
Thank you. As you say it slipped your memory, but you do now recall it. So, and then when you went to Station Road, did you see those men who were behaving suspiciously?
No, I did not. They'd gone by the time I got there.
Tell me, please, how do you know that?
Well, obviously, because they weren't there.
If they were not there, then how do you know they'd been there in the first place?
Well, that's what I presumed happened, naturally.
Officer, I'm making it plain to you, I hope, that what I am suggesting to you is that the anonymous call from the coin box to the police station was to make it sure that a policeman would be in the Station Road at the same time as the accused was in it.
I wouldn't say that.
You mean you couldn't say that, officer? Well, not possibly. How could you? You have made your point, Mr. Bendrahieri, but of course, obviously, the officer cannot be asked to express an opinion one way or the other about it, as I'm sure you know.
No, of course, Your Honour. Nor did I ask him to. Officer, you know the accused, George Mitchell, by sight, do you not?
I do know him, yes.
Your Honour, it is no part of the defence's intention to conceal the fact that the accused has a criminal record. I think it will make it easier to understand certain things for members of the jury if this matter was to be made quite clear at this point.
Yes, well, if you feel it's right to do so, Mr. Vendrahieri. I'm sure this is something that you and your client have gone into very seriously.
So, as we were saying, officer, you know the accused by sight. You were well aware that he was, in fact, a prisoner on parole, serving a sentence in Fulchester Prison. So when you saw him in the Station Road, you knew who he was and what he was. Is that not correct?
At first, I was not absolutely sure that it was the same person.
But if you were in any doubt, he had in his jacket pocket, and he showed you at once, did he not, the license from the prison hostel saying he had permission to be out that day.
I believe he did show me such a piece of paper from the prison, yes.
Officer, what reason did you have when you saw the accused come out of the shop to call him back to you and search him?
Merely his general demeanor.
A man coming out of a small corner grocer's shop on a Sunday afternoon in a quiet road. Why, what is so suspicious about that, please?
Well, for one thing, he shouted over his shoulder at the shopkeeper as he came out.
And that was sufficient for you to go after him, to stop him, and later to search him?
I considered it to be so, yes.
What was it then he shouted out that made you do that?
Enoch is right. All you bloody wogs should go back to where you came from.
Will you tell the court your full name and address?
Richard Edward Stephen Moffat Cunningham. My address is... I'm sorry, do you want my permanent address?
Oh, please.
My permanent address, I live with my parents, is Mill House, Parkside Grove, Fulchester.
And what is your occupation?
I am a soldier.
With the rank of lieutenant, I believe.
Yes, ma'am. The 3rd Regiment, the Royal Engineers.
And you will, in fact, be flying back and rejoining your unit in the British Army on the Rhine tonight, will you not?
Yes, ma'am. If that's possible, please, yes.
Yes, I hope Your Honour will not object. That is why I'm taking this witness first, even though...
Oh, certainly. Of course, Miss Travers.
Thank you, Your Honour. Lieutenant Cunningham, you were at home on leave on the weekend of Sunday, September the 25th last year.
Yes, I was. Well, actually, I was staying up in town with a couple of friends and I sort of popped home for Sunday lunch.
And who else was present at your home that day?
No one. Well, there was my mother and father, myself and George, Mr. Mitchell.
Mr. Mitchell. Had you met him at your home before?
Oh, yes, lots of times. We used to say he was almost one of the family.
Mm-hmm. Now, the defence has already raised this subject, so you've no need to worry about speaking of it. Lieutenant, did you know that he had a criminal record?
Oh, yes.
Mm. Now, did something particular transpire during lunch that day, or rather soon after it?
You mean about the cigarette lighter?
Something particular transpired about that, did it?
Well, it all began with my father, I suppose. He sometimes likes to have a cigar after Sunday lunch. And he went to the mantelpiece box to get one out and then was fumbling in his pockets for some matches, I suppose. So I thought this was just the opportunity to show off this new gold lighter this girl had given me. Well, I'd met her at a party the week before. So I took it out with a bit of a flourish and lit it for him.
Yes. Well, what happened then?
Well, there was a sort of laughing, a spot of leg pulling from Father and George about the sort of wealthy young ladies I must mix with. And then I don't remember seeing it again.
Well, I'm sure you don't mean that you put it in your pocket and perhaps it slipped
through. Oh, no, I'm afraid I'm not being awfully clear. Now, what I mean is I don't remember seeing it after George... I'm sorry, after Mr. Mitchell had it.
He had it? Mr. Mitchell, the accused, had it?
Well, only to look at. I handed it to him to see and... no, or rather, Father did. And then he gave it back to me. And, well, I suppose I must have put it down on one of the coffee tables or something. All I know is that when my father and I were out on the Princess a couple of hours later and he asked me for a light for the kettle, it wasn't in any of my pockets and I certainly didn't have it then.
I beg your pardon. On what, Lieutenant Cunningham?
I'm sorry?
You said on the Princess.
Oh, the Princess Jasmine. It's a boat. Well, a sort of motor yacht thing we keep down at the marina.
Ah, yes, I see. Thank you.
My father and I went out for a little potter around the estuary for a couple of hours to get some sea air before I had to go back to town.
And it was then, when you were on the boat, that it became apparent to you that you no longer had the lighter.
Yes, sir. My father said not to worry, he'd look after it until I came home again. So, as far as I was concerned, I never gave it another thought.
Mm. May he be shown Exhibit 5? Is that your cigarette lighter?
Yes.
Thank you, Lieutenant.
Excuse me, may I say something?
No, thank you, Lieutenant. Not unless it's in answer to a question, and I have no more questions that I want to put to you. Thank you.
Lieutenant Cunningham, whose idea was it that you should come to give evidence?
How do you mean, whose idea was it? It was mine.
Would it not have been simpler for you to have excused yourself on the grounds of your military duties without all the trouble to fly here from Germany?
Well, you know, family, United Family and all that. Father said we should all rally round.
Oh, I see. It was your father's idea. Thank you.
Well, I jolly well wouldn't have come if I didn't agree with him. I can tell you that.
Lieutenant Cunningham, do you smoke?
No, actually, I don't, no.
So the cigarette lighter was no use to you. What were you going to do with it?
Well, after then, I hadn't really thought about it, to be honest. Give it to Oxfam or something, I suppose.
Lieutenant Cunningham, I'm going to suggest to you that you said to the accused George Mitchell something like, why don't you keep it, George? It's more use to you than it is to me.
Now, look here, you don't honestly and seriously...
No, one moment, Lieutenant. I'm not suggesting that you gave the lighter to Mr. Mitchell. What it is I'm suggesting to you is that you said something like this as a joke, but that he nevertheless refused it and said that the proper thing to do was for you to give it back to the young lady and say to her, you did not smoke. Do you remember this?
Unhappily, I'm afraid I don't, no. But I must be absolutely honest and truthful about this. We'd had a fair old drop of the old vino with lunch, and I couldn't truthfully swear to the actual wording and things.
Ah, so the fact is, you have no idea at all as to what happened to the lighter.
Yes, I suppose that's about it, actually, yes. You see, that's what I can't get over about the whole thing, which is what I wanted to say before.
What was that, Lieutenant?
Well, George, Mr. Mitchell, knew that if he was up against it, short of a couple of hundred, he'd only have to come to me and I'd help him out. He didn't need to pinch things from us. Honestly, George, you knew that, surely, didn't you? I'm awfully sorry.
No, no, please. Thank you, Lieutenant.
Miss Travers, do you want to re-examine your witness?
No, thank you, Your Honour.
Right. Well, thank you, Lieutenant Cunningham. And may I express to you the court's appreciation for the trouble you've taken in coming here today for this case?
Not at all, sir.
You're, of course, now free to leave the court and rejoin your unit.
Thank you,
sir. I call Mrs. Vivian Cunningham.
Vivian Cunningham, please.
And a girl, all right?
And you are what is called a voluntary associate, Mrs. Cunningham, is that correct?
Yes.
Will you tell the court what that is exactly, what it means?
Well, it's something like a prison visitor, you could say. Only working with offenders when they're outside prison, rather than when they're still inside.
You mean helping with their aftercare and so on?
Well, trying to. Mainly just by being a friend who'll help them in finding a job, somewhere to live and so on.
And how long have you been doing it?
Oh, I suppose for six, no more, probably 8 years by now.
And how many ex-prisoners have you helped in that time?
Well, I don't know that I've helped all that many at all, really. Most of the effort has to come from the person themselves.
Well, how many people have you been involved in working with then, shall we say, over that time?
Over the whole period, I suppose, something like a total of 24 men and, say, 7 or 8 women.
And have
only
you
I'd
ever...
like to...
Oh, I'm so sorry.
What I was going to say was that I think it gives rather a misleading impression to talk of my work as though it meant a series of short-term involvements. You may get to know someone, help them find a job, somewhere to live, and then something goes wrong, and for one reason or another, they get into trouble once more, and soon they find themselves back in prison. But if you've managed to establish some degree of mutual contact, you keep in touch with them while they're in prison with letters and visits, and then when they come out, you try again. And this time you might be more successful. What I'm trying to say is that you try to look on it as a continuing relationship.
And how long have you been a voluntary associate to Mr. Mitchell?
I was first put in touch with him by a probation officer, it must be about 4 years ago now. She said she was worried about him while he was in prison because there'd been a degree of some domestic trouble. His wife had left him and gone to live with her mother, taking their two toddlers. As a result, this left him with nowhere to live and nothing to go straight for, nothing to want to keep straight for.
And so you took him on, as it were?
I visited him a couple of times and he agreed to give it a try. Mm.
So what actually happened when he came out?
I have a friend who gave him a room at a nominal rent to begin with. And my husband was also able to put him in touch with someone in the shop-fitting business, and he gave him a job. Mr. Mitchell worked hard and was very reliable. He did some work for us at our home and for one or two friends of mine, designing, building patios, whatever. And in a short while, he'd got together sufficient money to get himself a very nice, large, unfurnished flat. And in about 6 months, he and his wife and children were reunited and they came back to live with him again.
But then things began to go wrong again.
Yes, I'm afraid they did. After only another very few months, his wife once again returned to live with her mother, and he very quickly went downhill. took up with another lady briefly, I believe. But he was soon back in prison.
But you kept in touch with him?
Oh, yes, I did. Throughout the whole of his present sentence, which... Oh, I don't know if I should...
Oh, yes, you can speak quite freely, Mrs. Cunningham.
He's now nearing the end of his sentence, and at the time this incident occurred, I think he had only about another 6 months to serve.
This particular Sunday, which concerns us, the 25th of September last year, the day Mr. Mitchell came to lunch. Now, will you tell the court, Mrs. Cunningham, in your own words, what happened on that day?
I would like to be. I'm going to be absolutely straightforward about this. So I must say at once that my recollections are in some ways rather vague. My son in the army had come to visit us for the day. I had one, possibly two, sherries before lunch. And he had brought us a couple of bottles of wine over from Germany. I myself only had half a glassful because I am and have been for some time on a course of drugs from my doctor, which have the effect that, well, the least alcohol makes me quickly really rather drowsy. When the meal was over, I'd served coffee. I went upstairs, having excused myself, and lay down for about an hour or so.
I'd just like to have this made completely plain, Mrs. Cunningham. Were you under the influence of drink, are you saying?
Oh, no.
And what else do you recollect?
Well, very little, I'm afraid. I dozed. I think I must have for about an hour. When I got up again, there was no one at all in the house. I presume the three men had gone off, as they'd been talking of doing, down to the boat.
Now, Mrs. Cunningham, these articles of jewellery, when did you last see them? Where were they kept?
The diamond and amethyst ring and the silver filigree bracelet were on my dressing table. I'd been wearing them the night before when we went to some friends for supper. My daughter's gold and enamel necklet, I think that was in her room. Or what used to be her room. She's left home now. It could have been anywhere there. She was always rather untidy, I'm afraid.
And the accused, was he at times alone, on his own, during that lunchtime? Would he have had the opportunity to take them?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, and a garnet ring. Ask her about that.
Be quiet, please.
Mr. Mitchell, you really mustn't interrupt. Your turn will come in due course. Please be silent until then.
So, Mrs. Cunningham, when you later discovered that the accused had been arrested in the street by a policeman and taken to the police station, and that the articles were discovered in his possession, were you surprised?
Amazed. Horrified. I suppose the most exact word I could use would be stunned.
Thank you, Mrs. Cunningham.
Mr. Vandraheri.
Serona. Mrs. Cunningham, for some time you and the accused were lovers, were you not?
I beg your pardon. What on earth do you mean?
It is quite clear, is it not? You and he frequently had, whenever suitable opportunities presented themselves, regular sexual intercourse. Is that not so?
Join us again tomorrow when the case of the Queen against Mitchell will be resumed in the Crown Court. At 3 o'clock on a Sunday afternoon, George Mitchell was stopped in the street by a policeman who asked to see what was in the pockets of an expensive cashmere overcoat he was carrying, and discovered there items of jewellery, which George Mitchell denied all knowledge of, and which were the possessions of the Cunningham family. And Mitchell's counsel has suggested that Mrs. Cunningham and George Mitchell are lovers.
Well, are you going to be so kind as to give me an answer to my question, please, Mrs. Cunningham?
Yes, I'll answer your question.
Thank you.
It's preposterous.
The suggestion that you and the accused are or ever have been lovers, it is preposterous?
Yes.
You absolutely deny it?
I do, absolutely and emphatically.
Remembering, of course, that you are on oath, you have never had sexual intercourse with him?
Never.
Mrs. Cullingham, please. You are on oath and you are absolutely...
Your Honour, really, I must protest at this. Mrs. Cunningham has given her answer repeatedly.
Yes, it does seem to me that she has answered the question, Mr. Vandraheri, and that it's wrong of you to persist in this fashion.
Well, if I have distressed Mrs. Cunningham, I'm sorry, but I am sure it equally distresses the accused also to hear their close and intimate relationship so untruthfully denied.
Your Honour, really, this is quite outrageous. If my learned friend wishes to give evidence, then let him go into the box.
You know, you really must not say such things, Mr. Vandraheri. I was scarcely even a comment, and even a comment would have been improper at this stage of the proceedings.
So I withdraw the remark, Your Honour, and tender my apologies to you. Mrs. Cunningham, the garnet ring, exhibit number 6 it is, I believe. That was given to you by the accused, was it not?
Yes, it was.
When?
I think he just came with it to the house a few months ago when he was working on some alterations to our kitchen for us and said he'd like me to have it.
It was to mark a particularly enjoyable experience of sexual intercourse that you and he had had in bed together
the
previous day when he'd been at your house.
Mr. Vandraheri must be allowed to put his case in
his
own way.
With respect, this line of questioning is not upsetting me in the least. I would much prefer that any questions were asked and I was given the opportunity to answer them. It's not upsetting me, not in any way. Please ask me whatever you wish.
Thank you.
Mr. Vandraheri, I'm sure you're aware of the dangers of running this kind of defence. However, of course, you may continue if you wish.
Your Honour, Mrs. Cunningham, I put it to you that on September 25th, last year, the accused arrived at your house in the late morning, your husband and son having gone out for a drink before lunch, and that you then took the opportunity to tell him that you now had another lover who was insisting your association with him should come to an end.
No, that is completely untrue. There never was and never had been any association of the sort that you're suggesting between us. So there was nothing to come to an end, either at my or anyone else's suggestion.
I put it to you also that he begged and pleaded with you to change your mind, pointing out that on no less than 3 occasions in the past 4 years, his wife had left him because of his continuing liaison with you.
No, that is pure fantasy.
Well, Mrs. Cunningham, do you recall an occasion when the accused was out of prison before the sentence he's at present serving, when his wife, Mrs. Mitchell, came to see you?
Yes. Yes, I think I do, actually.
And why did she come to see you?
Well, I don't remember clearly now.
Mrs. Cunningham?
I think, I presume it must have been something to do with her husband.
I put it to you that she came to see you to ask you to give him up.
I doubt it. Or if she did, hardly for the reason you're suggesting.
You think there is something amusing in this suggestion? May we be permitted to share what is so humorous about it, please?
I'm sorry. I meant not afraid of losing him to me. Afraid, perhaps, of my influencing him away from crime.
You now suggest his wife has criminal affiliations.
Oh, that's hardly a great deal to complain about, Mr. Vandraheri, when one considers some of the suggestions about herself that this witness has been subjected to.
Mrs. Cunningham, I have no more questions to put to you.
Mrs. Cunningham, there are just 2 things I would like to ask you briefly and finally. I'm sure, without myself or anyone else stressing it, you are aware that you could be described as an extremely attractive woman. Is it totally outside your previous experience as a voluntary associate that a prisoner should indulge in strong sexual fantasies about you?
No.
Thank you, Mrs. Cunningham. And finally, I would be right in saying that as a woman, one is vulnerable always to accusations if one is doing something even slightly charitable, to hints and sniggers and whispers that one is doing it for, well, to use a popular expression, for kicks of some kind or another.
Yes, very much so.
Thank you, Mrs. Cunningham.
Thank you, Mrs. Cunningham.
I call Douglas Cunningham.
Douglas Cunningham, please.
What is your religion?
Church of England.
Take the book in your right hand and read aloud the words on the card.
I swear by Almighty God that the evidence I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Will you tell the court your full name and address, please?
Yes. Douglas Arthur Moffat DeWitt Cunningham, Millhouse, Parkside Grove, Fulchester.
Thank you. Will you tell the court, Mr. Cunningham, in your own words, please, the events of that day, Sunday, the 25th of September, last year?
Yes. My son, who was on weekend leave from BAOR, came up that morning to lunch with us from town. He arrived about 11:30, something like that. What happened then? Yes, he and I went over to the windmill for a drink.
Yes.
When we got
just
back,
a minute, please, Mr. Cunningham. When your son arrived, before you and he went off for this pre-lunch drink, was there anyone else in the house besides your wife, Vivian?
Anyone else? Oh, Mitch. You mean Mr. Mitchell. No, I'm fairly certain he hadn't arrived by then. Yes, in fact, definitely he hadn't. No, he was there when we got back, though. Yes, that's quite right. Now, as I was saying, we all had lunch together.
Yes, did you have anything else to drink before lunch? I mean, after you and your son had got back from the pub?
A couple of sherries, perhaps, possibly, or so.
Were you drunk?
Oh, good Lord, no. We're not great drinkers, any of us. Vivian was a bit off colour, though. She's been on some sort of pills, I understand, for something or other. I know that someone is only to take the stopper out of the sherry decanter, and she begins to feel a bit dizzy.
And Mr. Mitchell, was he? What about him?
Oh, he wasn't drunk when he left, no.
What time did he leave, Mr. Cunningham?
About 2:45 or somewhere thereabouts, I should think, yes.
And he left on his own, not with you?
Yes. Vivian had gone upstairs to lie down. She wasn't feeling very well. Richard and I thought we'd take the boat out for a while on the estuary. We asked Mitch if he'd like to come along with us, but he said no, he thought he ought to be getting along. So off he went. At least, as far as I know, he did.
And what time did you and your son leave?
About 10 minutes later.
Mr. Mitchell left the house quite normally and amicably.
Yes, certainly. Well, again, as far as I know, he did.
Mr. Cunningham, did you give him any jewellery of your wife's or your children's?
No, I did not.
Did you give him your coat?
No.
Did you know that he had taken your coat?
No. Not until the police rang up some time later to say that he was down there at the station and the coat was with him, no.
Can you think of any reason why he should have taken it?
No. Well...
Yes?
Well, it had turned a bit chilly. I suppose he might have borrowed it in order to... Still, that wouldn't explain the jewellery, would it?
Thank you, Mr. Cunningham. I'm sorry if this comes as a bit of a surprise to you, but may I finish by just asking you something completely different? Will you tell the court, please, how long you and your wife have been married?
Yes, 22... 23 now. 23 years.
And is it, and has it been a happy marriage, do you mind my asking?
The happiest I've had.
Thank you, Mr. Cunningham.
Mr. Cunningham, since my learned friend has finished on this subject, perhaps I may begin on it. Have you ever threatened your wife to divorce her?
No.
Has she ever said to you that she wanted to be divorced from you?
No.
Have you ever separated and lived apart from her?
No.
Have you always approved of your wife's work as, what is it called, a voluntary associate with prisoners?
No.
Have you always fully... I'm sorry, I beg your pardon. Did you just say you had not always approved of your wife's work?
Yes, I did say that.
Why was that?
Well, I've sometimes felt, to be perfectly honest, that it was often quite dangerous. I mean in the sense of the type of people she might find herself involved with.
Well, it could not unreasonably be said that you may well sometimes have had good reason for those fears, Mr. Cunningham.
Now, Mr. Cunningham, have you always fully felt that as far as your wife was concerned, you could completely trust the people
Your
that...
Honour...
Yes, Miss Travers. Mr. Vendraheri, if you are going to put the question which it sounded that you were going to put, I am not going to let you put it.
With respect, Your Honour, may I put my question, please?
Mr. Vendraheri, if you intend to persist in the way you appear to be going, and in face of what I have just said, I must warn you that it will be a very serious matter.
Yes, Your Honour. I will nevertheless, with Your Honour's permission, put my question, please. Thank you. Mr. Cunningham, I was about to ask you if you always felt that, as far as your wife was concerned, you could fully trust the people she invited to your house from time to time, not to steal any of your many doubtless valuable possessions.
I've always felt that it was entirely up to my wife's judgment, whom she invited and whom she chose not to risk. And I...
And yes, I'm sorry, you were wanting to say something else?
Yes, I'm not sure perhaps whether I should say it. What I was going to say is that her judgment has always been so very good that we've never once been let down. Well, previously.
Ah, I see no reason why you shouldn't say that, Mr. Cunningham, since there are some guilty pleas.
Mr. Cunningham, your overcoat, exhibit number one it is, I think. Not on this occasion, but previously on two occasions, it was lent to the accused to go back to the prison hostel in after he'd been at your home, was it not?
Yes, yes, I believe that's right. Yes, that's quite correct.
Who was it lent to him by, Mr. Cunningham?
I'm sorry, I don't think I follow you.
Well, I will put it straight to you. It was twice lent to the accused by your wife, and when you found out about it, you were extremely angry.
No, it would perhaps be true to say that I was not very pleased. I was certainly not extremely angry.
And on the Sunday in question, when it was, as you said, chilly after lunch, and your overcoat was hanging in a prominent position near the door, the accused took...
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm right in saying, am I not, that the accused has pleaded guilty to stealing this coat?
Yes, Your Honour.
Is he changing his plea?
No, Your Honour.
Well, then, I fail to grasp the point of your questioning. This is just time-wasting, isn't it, surely?
With respect, Your Honour, I'm having great difficulty.
Yes, I know you are, Mr. Vendraheri, but I really can't help saying that I think a lot of it is of your own causing. However, if you wish to proceed in the way you are, we will all be as patient as we can about it.
Thank you, Your Honour. Mr. Cunningham, I'm sure not you or I wants to tax His Honour's patience. So finally, I will ask you about one other matter. After the accused had left your home on the Sunday in question, did you make a telephone call?
A telephone call to whom?
Mr. Cunningham, do not ask me questions, just answer the ones that I ask you. After the accused left your home, did you make a telephone call?
No, I did not.
How long does it take you to drive from your house to where your boat was?
About 10, 12 minutes.
Did you make a telephone call either on your way or when you got there from a coin box?
No, I did not.
Mr. Cunningham,
oh, I'm terribly sorry. Yes, indeed, I've quite forgotten. Yes, I did make a telephone call from a phone box when I got to the marina.
To whom?
To the Coast Guard. To inquire about what the weather was likely to be doing for the next 2 hours when we were out on the boat on the water.
Mr. Cunningham, I put it to you that you made a telephone call to the police.
Tripe.
I beg your pardon?
I beg yours, sir. A cow's intestine or stomach thereof, meaning rubbish.
What is your religion?
Survey.
Take the book in your right hand and read aloud the words on the card.
I swear by Almighty God that the evidence I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Please state your full name to the court.
George Arthur Mitchell.
Mr. Mitchell, you have pleaded guilty to the theft of the overcoat and the garnet ring.
I have.
Why is that?
Of course I am.
And not guilty to the theft of the diamond and amethyst ring, the silver filigree bracelet, the gold cigarette lighter, and the gold and enamel necklet.
I have.
Why is that?
Of course I ain't.
Now, Mr. Mitchell, will you please tell the court why you took Mr. Cunningham's overcoat on the Sunday in question?
I weren't thinking. I'd had a bit of drink, like, and I was upset, weren't I? Stupid, I suppose. That's what it comes down to, though, doesn't it? That's all.
Mr. Vendraheri, is this a plea of mitigation about stealing the overcoat?
No, Your Honour.
I see. Well, doubtless you will conduct this in your own way. I just wanted to clear the situation in my own head and help the members of the jury, who may be a little puzzled, as I am.
Yes, Your Honour. May I proceed, please?
Oh, please, yes. Doubtless it will become clear as we continue.
Thank you. Mr. Mitchell, why particularly did you take this overcoat?
Of course, it was cold.
Yes, it was cold too, but why this overcoat?
Oh, yeah, I see what you're... Well, because I'd had it before, like, oh, no, yeah.
You had borrowed it before.
Right. I wasn't thinking, was I, see, what would a drink and other things, like the big ruck I'd had with her in it. Didn't ask. That was the point, see, wasn't it? Just took it from where it was hanging by the front door, didn't I? And I should have asked, see what I mean?
However, Mr. Mitchell, you go away, and while you are going along the street, you go into a shop. And when you come out of the shop, what happens?
Well, there's this copper there waiting for me to come out, isn't he?
The policeman says he just happens to be walking along the street, and his attention is drawn to you because you come out from the shop shouting. Is that so?
Nah. I mean, yeah, I come out the shop shouting and that, but he'd already seen me going in the first place, didn't he? I mean, he couldn't have said what I've been shouting, could he, if he hadn't been standing there already waiting to hear it like? See what I mean?
Something like, Enoch is right, all you walk should go back where you come from, you mean?
Yeah. 9 people, 2 packets of fag papers, I mean to ask you. And like I said, I had had a bit of drink like two, so I was a bit, when I anyhow. But I'm not racially prejudiced, though. He asked me about the coat, where I'd got it in it. Well, so I told him a lie. Said it had been lent me, didn't I? I thought she'd back me up if he phoned up the house like I said to him to. I mean, seeing as how she'd given me before, like, know what I mean?
You thought Mrs. Cunningham would say it was all right you should have the coat, temporarily, on loan, as it were. Is this what you're saying?
Right, yeah, and that was me doubtful, wasn't it? Yeah, didn't know what was in the pockets then, did I? No.
What was in the pockets being the diamond ring, the silver bracelet, the gold cigarette lighter,
Richards,
the golden enamel necklet?
Young Diane's.
It is your contention.
Diane? Have we heard of her, Diane?
Diane Cunningham, Mrs. Cunningham's daughter, Your Honour.
Oh, yes, thank you.
And it is your contention, Mr. Mitchell, is it not, that all these articles were quite deliberately placed in the overcoat pocket by another person?
A fit-up, yeah.
Mr. Mitchell.
A fit-up means that you're saying some person planted them in the pockets of the coat. Is that right?
Right, yeah. Him.
Mr. Cunningham.
Has to be, doesn't it?
But what reason can he have had? I mean, surely... Sorry. I leave this to you, Mr. Vendraheri. I do beg your pardon.
Thank you. Mr. Mitchell, the only item which has not so far been mentioned is the garnet ring.
Right.
How did that come to be in the overcoat pocket?
Well, it didn't, did it? In this pocket here. And when they turned me over at a police station, they put it in with the others like it was with them in the overcoat.
And it is Mr. Cunningham, you say, who put the other jewellery in the overcoat pocket?
2 things of hers, 1 thing of Richard's, 1 thing of Diane's. Make it look bad for me with every one of them. See what I mean?
So how did the garnet ring come to be in your jacket pocket?
Well, I put it there, didn't I? When I said to her, all right, I'm taking my ring back then, when I took it off of her dressing table.
When was that?
Well, before, like, when we was having the ruck, when we were waiting for her husband and Richard coming back from lunch for the pub.
The quarrel you were having when she told you something?
About this other fella, yeah.
Well, do I have this clear? You're saying, are you, Mr. Mitchell, that although you had given the ring to Mrs. Cunningham, you still felt it was yours? I'm taking my ring back.
Right.
Well, then, I don't quite see why, if you're saying that the ring was anyway yours all the time, you're pleading guilty to stealing it.
Well, because I give it a see, didn't I?
You just said it was yours.
Yeah. I give it her, then I took it off her. It was mine when I give it her, but when I give it her, it was hers. So if I took it off her, well, theoretically then, in law, that's right, innit? I did. I nicked it off her, right, didn't I? See what I mean?
Yes. Well, thank you for that explanation.
Thank you, Mr. Mitchell.
Mr. Mitchell, it's already been admitted that you do have a record, the offences for which you were in prison on that Sunday, September the 25th. Now, what in general terms were they?
Well, you know, just ordinary, straightforward thieving and that.
Thieving? Stealing other people's property?
Well, no, it wasn't other people's property, actually. It was the post office in order for...
No, Mr. Mitchell, please don't be specific. But at your trial, when you were charged with that offence, what was your plea?
Not guilty, of course.
Well, why was that?
Oh, God, what do you expect?
With respect, Your Honour, I would submit that the accused's pleas at his earlier trial have nothing to do with this present case.
Miss Travers?
Your Honour, I thought I was simply following in my learned friend's footsteps, but since it seems to upset him so much, I will not pursue the subject. Mr. Mitchell, during your answers to your own counsel, you noticeably omitted some of the very extreme and unpleasant accusations that had been made against certain prosecution witnesses during cross-examination, did you not?
He said he thought it was going down bad with the jury, see?
Ah, well, that sounds like an honest answer, Mr. Mitchell. Let us see if you can continue in that way. Now, let me put one or two things to you very simply, may I? You are still asking us to believe that you and Mrs. Cunningham have been having a close and intimate relationship for 4 years or so?
Right.
A point which hasn't been mentioned, or if it has, I'm certainly not at all clear about it. Are you saying that her husband minded or he did not mind?
Well, I used to think he didn't, but now, you know, I think he must have. She always said he didn't, that they had this arrangement, like what you read about people having, you know. He went with his women and he just didn't care what she did one way or the other. I mean, she said years ago there'd been talk of a divorce and that, and they'd separated once when he was really took up with someone else, but nothing come of it, so they've got this...
Mr. Mitchell, this is all entirely fantasy, isn't it?
Fantasy?
Fairy tale, make-believe, all made up.
Well, I didn't think it was. I thought it was all true. I believed that, honestly.
No, Mr. Mitchell, by you.
How? I see what you... That she said them things, you mean?
Yes.
No. She said them, all right.
Yes, but Mrs. Cunningham...
I don't know her anymore, do I? I mean, see what I mean? It's funny somehow, isn't it? All along, I've been thinking, he fitted me up. Last couple of months. All the nights in the nick, on remand, waiting for the trial to come up. Thinking the same thing all the time. He fitted me up. But all of a sudden, like, it's hit me. Perhaps I'm doing him an injustice. You see what I mean? Perhaps it wasn't... Perhaps it was her.
Mr. Mitchell, these are your fantasies. Your fantasies. Where is there the remotest proof that there's ever been a relationship of the kind you say between yourself and Mrs. Cunningham?
Your Honour, I would suggest that such remarks by my learned friend are completely out of place for her to make to the accused. The witnesses for the defence are still to be called.
Yes, Miss Travers, there is something in that, you know.
Your Honour.
Mr. Mitchell. Mr. Mitchell. Despite what my learned friend was saying about there so far being no evidence for it, you have been, for some 4 years, deeply involved with Mrs. Cunningham, have you not?
I have.
What was your feelings for her?
Love.
And what are they now?
Same.
The same. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mitchell. You may leave the witness box.
I will now call Mrs. Pauline Mitchell.
Tomorrow, you can join us again when the case of the Queen against Mitchell will be concluded in the Crown Court. George Mitchell is charged that while he was a serving prisoner out on license from the prison hostel, he stole a coat and articles of jewellery from the home of Vivian and Douglas Cunningham. Vivian is a voluntary prison worker who befriended him. He alleges they've been having a love affair, and the jewellery was planted on him either by her or her husband. Mitchell's wife has just been called to give evidence for the defence.
And what did he say to you on the second occasion, Mrs. Mitchell?
Oh, same as before. He couldn't help what he felt. He tried to get her out of his system, but he couldn't. He knew he wasn't her class. He hadn't got no education, he hadn't got the money, position, nothing. But whatever he had or he hadn't, there was nothing he could do. He just couldn't help himself. He was, well... It can't be called anything else. Be stotted.
So, what did you do?
I went to see her.
For what reason, Mrs. Mitchell?
To ask her to give him up.
What was her reaction to that?
She said, it wasn't her fault if that was the effect she had on men. What did I expect her to do about it?
And what did you say, Mrs. Mitchell?
I said I expected her to remind him that even if he didn't care about his wife, he still had two kids who loved him and needed him.
And what did she say to that?
Oh, nothing I remember especially. Just sort of laughed it off and said she'd have to try and make him not so enthusiastic about her, wouldn't she?
This was 4 years ago.
About.
Mrs. Mitchell, is there any hope at all, do you think, of a reconciliation between yourself and your husband?
Well, not while she's around. People like us, we don't stand a cat and hell's chance. Not while there's people like them.
So why have you come to give evidence? Why have you agreed to do all this?
The kids. Well, at least he might come and see them sometime. I've done him a turn. Perhaps he'll do one for me.
Thank you, Mrs. Mitchell.
Mrs. Mitchell, you and your husband, you've been married for how long?
8 years.
Hmm. And your marriage is not by any means the only one in the world to have broken down, is it?
No.
Nor are you by any means the only woman in the world to put the blame for such a situation on another woman, are you?
No, I suppose not.
Hmm. Now, Mrs. Mitchell, was there an occasion some few years ago when your husband had a liaison with another woman? Not Mrs. Cunningham, some other woman?
Oh, that's because
he was... Now, just answer the question that I asked you, Mrs. Mitchell. Did your husband live with another woman for a short while?
Yeah.
Thank you, Mrs. Cunningham. Just a moment. Just one final question, Mrs. Mitchell. Did you make a telephone call to Mrs. Cunningham some 3 weeks or so ago, saying that you were a bit short of money and that the children needed a few things, and if she could see her way clear to helping you, you might consider not coming to give evidence in this case?
No, I did not.
You did not what, Mrs. Mitchell? Make the telephone call or make the suggestion?
Neither. I didn't do neither.
Hmm.
I do not wish to re-examine the witness, Your Honour.
Thank you, then, Mrs. Mitchell. You may leave the witness box.
I will now call Miss Diane Cunningham.
Diane Cunningham.
What is your religion?
I haven't got a religion. Can I affirm?
Oh, yes. Just read aloud the words on this card.
I do solemnly, sincerely, and truly declare and affirm that the evidence I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Would you please state your full name and address to the court?
Diane Vivian Armand Cunningham, Avenida Jose Antonio, 104. Sorry, I mean I live at 134 Jose Antonio Avenue, Barcelona.
What is your occupation, Miss Cunningham?
I'm a reader and translator for a newspaper.
How long have you lived in Spain?
Just over 1 year.
At whose expense have you come here to give evidence at this trial, Miss Cunningham?
My own.
Thank you. How long is it since you have last seen Mr. Mitchell?
Mr. Ventaheri, you've not yet established that she knows Mr. Mitchell.
Well, I do, but I haven't seen him since before I went to Spain.
For over a year, that is. Have you been in touch with him at all in any other way?
No.
How did you first know this trial was to take place, Miss Cunningham?
Well, Mitch wrote to me when he was in prison on remand, waiting for the case to come up.
And why did he write to you? To ask you for your help?
No, to say that he knew that he'd be going back to prison again, and when I heard about it, he just wanted me to know that he hadn't stolen or tried to steal anything from me. Not that I needed telling that. I mean, I know he wouldn't steal anything from me. I'd have known it was a setup.
How would you know that, Miss Cunningham?
Because it's happened before.
May we be quite specific about this? You say you know of a previous situation arranged by your parents where some other person would get into trouble with the law?
Yes.
And was it as a result of that that you left home and went away?
Well, yes, in some ways. Not entirely, but it did have something to do with it. I'd been on increasingly bad terms with my parents for some time, and when I heard about that, as far as I was concerned, it was just one more example of... well, it simply confirmed that I wanted to get as far away from them and everything they represented as I could.
Miss Cunningham, to turn now to the subject of these alleged offences, your gold and enamel necklet, which was found in the accused's possession, how was it that it was in your parents' house and not with you where you live in Barcelona?
Well, when I left home, I didn't take any valuable personal possessions with me. I left what little jewellery I have here.
Here? Where, Miss Cunningham?
Well, in a small jewellery case, which I then hid away behind a false panel in the back of some fitted wardrobes in what used to be my room at home.
Did anyone else beside yourself know it was there?
No one outside the family knew of the existence of the panel, and it was designed in such a way that no one could even guess its existence.
There were other items in this jewellery case?
Few, about six or seven.
Was the necklet the most valuable?
In money terms, no, not by any means.
But in what is known as sentimental value?
Oh, yes, it had been given to me by my godmother.
You are certain, Miss Cunningham, that you left the necklet in this particular place which only your family would have known about? I mean, you appreciate the implications
this would... Yes, I'm absolutely certain. The necklet could only have been taken by someone who knew where to look. In taking that piece and ignoring all the others, it made it very obvious to me that this was a deliberate thing to try and make me feel hurt by Mitch, as well as angry. It had exactly the opposite effect, though. It was so blatant, completely misfired. It made me more convinced than ever that they and their world absolutely stink.
Thank you, Miss Cunningham.
Miss Cunningham, I have got this right, have I? You've come here today entirely at your own expense, all the way from Barcelona, to give evidence against your parents?
No, I've come here to give evidence for George Mitchell. Oh,
well, that was hardly the impression you conveyed by your last word in your last sentence to my learned friend. However, you've come here to give evidence for Mr. Mitchell, you say. That's a rather unusual action. Of considerable extremity of effort, not to say marked dramatic effect for a young girl to take, isn't it?
Is it? I understand my brother did something rather similar on behalf of the prosecution.
Ah, but your brother is somewhat older, though, is he not? He also holds a position of high responsibility with Her Majesty's forces. How well do you know the accused, Miss Cunningham?
Well, not very well, if by that
no,
you're trying to suggest...
No, can we just stay with the answer, thank you? Not very well. And yet well enough, apparently, to say... I know he would not steal from me.
Yes.
That's a rather romanticized sort of assertion, wouldn't you agree?
No, I wouldn't.
Oh, I would say that it's in fact, and I'm sure you'll discover this too as you get older, about the commonest illusion held by anyone who's ever been robbed by someone that they knew, that they would never, ever steal from them. Now, this romantic attitude...
I don't have... I've never had a romantic attitude towards him.
Well, I'm not in any way criticising you for it. It's not in any way unusual for young girls to look at certain criminals through...
I happen to be 19, the tenant of a flat, the owner of a car, earning the equivalent of what would be £5,000 a year in
England. Oh, I am sorry, Miss Cunningham. I have forgotten how rapidly people age. But last year, 15 months or so ago, before you left England, would it not be true to say that you had what in other days might have been described as a crush on Mr. Mitchell?
On him? Sorry, Mitch, it would be totally incorrect.
Well, I am instructed that your infatuation for him was in fact a primary reason for your wanting to leave England.
What?
Was it not? As a result of your father's insistence that you should not mix with him and other undesirable characters, that you were, as you said yourself, on such bad terms with your parents.
You have to be joking.
Oh, I most certainly am not joking, Miss Cunningham. This is far too serious a matter for it. Is it not true that you were at that time associating with a number of people of whom your parents disapproved?
My father certainly did. These
Miss Cunningham,
who...
if you will just answer the question, please. And the answer, I gather, is yes. And had some of them served prison sentences?
Because of the authorities'
attitudes
towards...
Miss Cunningham, please, had some of them served prison sentences? Well, would
they
you
had.
Answer the question?
They had.
And was there not a possibility that at that time you yourself might be prosecuted? Answer the question, please.
There was a possibility that that might happen, yes, so I was given to understand by the police.
But in return for your leaving the college where you were at that time, being educated, your father managed to get you out of it.
In return for my being taken away from college, my father managed to get himself out of it.
Oh, yes, well, I'm afraid meaningless remarks like that have no place in a court of law, thank you. Now, one final matter, Miss Cunningham. You've been out of this country for over a year, you say?
Yes.
And in all that time, you've never been back, not even for a weekend or a day?
No.
So you are not actually in England on the day in question, Sunday, September the 25th?
No.
So, since you were not there at your parents' house on that day, you were not even in the country, in fact, you will agree, won't you, that you couldn't have the remotest idea of what actually happened?
I can guess.
Yes, you can guess, Miss Cunningham. You have done, and you continue to do so, with increasing wildness, maliciousness, and hurtfulness towards your own family.
Miss Cunningham, the people you were associating with, whom your parents disapproved of, how many of them had actually been in prison?
Who actually went to prison? Two.
How long were they sentenced to prison for?
One was in for 4 weeks and one was in for two.
And what was it for?
Non-payment of fines.
For what offences?
Obstructing the police.
In what circumstances, Miss Cunningham?
They were taking part in a non-violent demonstration against the war in Vietnam.
You do not need to be more specific. They were protesters in a matter of conscience.
Mr. Vendraheri, it does not really matter what it was for. They were obstructing the police in the execution of their duty. Are you suggesting that in some way that is not a serious offence?
No, Your Honour, only that it is not of the type one usually thinks of when one suggests the possession of a criminal record.
Well, that depends upon who does the thinking, doesn't it? I mean, to some people, the type of offence is not greatly relevant.
Your Honour, Miss Cunningham, the possibility of you yourself going to prison and being prosecuted, what was that for?
For throwing anti-apartheid leaflets at a demonstration.
Yes, just one moment, Miss Cunningham. What is the point, Mr. Vendraheri?
I am simply trying to establish and keep a perspective, Your Honour.
I must confess that to me, if someone breaks the law, they break the law and are guilty of an offence in so doing. Whether it is a law of which some people disapprove, of which some people think is not important, or even downright wrong, is neither here nor there, surely. It is the law.
Your Honour. Miss Cunningham, towards the end of your cross-examination, you said something which my learned friend described as a meaningless remark. It was something to the effect that in return for your leaving the college where you were being educated, your father got himself out of it. Will you tell us, please, what you mean by that?
There were daughters of several of my father's business associates at the college at the same time as I was, and in their parents' eyes, I and a few others were having far too much influence on them. When it looked as though I might be getting into trouble for demonstrating against the very companies that their parents owned, and it might attract some awkward publicity towards him, my father brought a great deal of pressure to bear on me, both financially and emotionally, and mistakenly I let him talk me out of it.
Thank you, Miss Cunningham. I have no more questions for you.
Thank you, Miss Cunningham.
I call Harry Stone, please.
Harry Stone, please.
What is your religion?
Simply.
Take the book in your right hand and read aloud the words on the card.
I swear by Almighty God that the evidence I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Will you please tell the court your full name?
Harold Stone.
And you're currently serving a prison sentence, Mr. Stone, which you received last year, is that correct?
That's right, yes I am.
Of what length is it?
3 years.
3 years. For what offences?
Being in possession of stolen property.
What was it, this stolen property?
Two vases, a small portable escritoire, an ivory and jade fan, and a carriage clock.
Was this your first offence?
Sorry. Not by any means, no.
What are you? What is your type of crime as a rule?
It's not as a rule. It's always. I'm a fence.
A receiver of stolen goods, Mr. Stone, is that correct?
Yes, Your Honour.
What do you mostly receive and fence, Mr. Stone?
Entirely motors.
Just motor cars? Never anything else at all?
No, never. I'm a specialist. All fences are. All of what you might call, well, a certain standard, that is. You have to know your markets, your sellers and your buyers. And, of course, know about the goods, too. You have to have an eye for them, be able to assess their market value quickly and so on.
You make it sound almost as though you're suggesting it's some claim merely to be described as a skilled occupation, Mr. Stone.
Oh, no, I wouldn't say that, Your Honour. There are too many of us.
Ah.
So, you don't ever deal in antiques, Mr. Stone?
No, never. Now, that is a specialised field, one you really got to know your way around in. If you don't, it's far too easy to get taken.
Mr. Stone, about this present sentence that you're serving...
You know, even some of the old bill were a bit dubious about it. One of them even said to me, 18th century porcelain in the back of a Hillman imp, Harry, whatever next. It wasn't until I heard this case being discussed in the Nick a couple of months ago that suddenly it all clicked. The gear. the antiques. They were a friend of his. One of his director pals in one of his companies.
This was at a time when you knew that lady and gentleman, Mrs. and Mr. Cunningham?
Well, I knew her rather better than I knew him. But I did know them both, yes.
How did you come to meet them?
She was taking an interest in the aftercare of one of my mates, and he introduced us.
She was concerning herself with your aftercare?
No, she wasn't that stupid.
Thank you, Mr. Stone.
Mr. Stone, we have it on your own admission that you do have a number of convictions for dishonesty.
One kind of dishonesty, yes.
Well, fascinating though it would be, I'm not going to ask you for a dissertation on the various kinds. Instead, will you just tell us this? Did you, at the trial you've been describing, presumably say then, too, that you'd been the victim of a fit-up, the planting of these things on you?
Yes.
Well, did the jury then, there, believe you?
No. Because I couldn't think of any reason why anyone should, and I couldn't think who would.
Really?
But she'd give me almost the same tale. There was this new chap who said she'd got to break it off with me.
Mr. Stone, you are not going to claim that you too had a liaison with Mrs. Cunningham.
I wouldn't claim to be the only one or anything like it. I mean, I never thought of it as more than it was. She liked it. I liked it. But when it was done, that was that.
And Mr. Cunningham, her husband, unaware, unconcerned?
No, of course not. He takes the films, the home movies.
Mr. Stone, did you say that at your trial?
No. I've told you I hadn't a clue what was going on then. But even if I had, well, I mean, look at him. Who'd believe it?
That concludes the case for the defence, Your Honour.
Thank you, Mr. Stone. Members of the jury, you may well feel that the only way to decide which side is the more convincing of the two is to consider in turn what each of their chosen witnesses said, whether what he or she said struck you as likely or not. And I suggest that when you consider it in that fashion, step by step, as it were, you'll find it that much easier to come to a sensible conclusion. So, consider, if you will, Mrs. Cunningham's evidence. Now, you may feel that there's something innately surprising in the possibility of a woman from one walk of life having an intimate sexual relationship with a man from another. But you cannot have lived, as I have for years, in the law and regard anything that people do as surprising or impossible. Now, the point surely is it likely between the people concerned, both of whom you have seen? Well, now let us consider the accused's contention that these articles were planted on him by Mr. and Mrs. or by Mr. or Mrs. Cunningham. We are to believe, apparently, that someone counted on the weather turning chilly and hung up an overcoat full of jewellery temptingly by the door and that the accused was then to take it of his own free will, without a by your leave, that next he would walk down a particular street, meet a policeman who was standing there who had somehow been tempted into going to that place. Well, now what if the accused had taken it into his head to go back to the prison hostel by some other route? He would have been made a present of some valuable jewellery. Surely, would he not? And now Miss Diane Cunningham's evidence. Members of the jury, perhaps those of you who have children yourselves may feel as sad as I do to see an intelligent, well-educated young woman go to such lengths to show her personal vindictiveness against her family, and so publicly too. But again, I can only ask you to consider whether this has anything to do with the subject of the charges against the accused, since, as was pointed out, she was not in the country at the time of the alleged offence. Finally, members of the jury, I will say as little as possible about the evidence of Mr. Stone, except to reiterate a point which I made in answer to some remarks of the accused about the spare time activities of Mr. and Mrs. Cunningham. Yes, all things are possible, but are they likely? And anyway, what on earth has it got to do with what you're here to decide, which is whether the accused is or is not guilty of the offences with which he is charged? Now, members of the jury, I will ask you to retire, elect a foreman to speak for you, and consider your verdict.
The prisoner will stand. Members of the jury, will your foreman please stand? Please answer this question, yes or no. Have you reached a verdict on which you are all agreed?
Yes.
On the first count, of stealing a diamond and amethyst ring and a silver filigree bracelet from Vivian Cunningham, do you find the accused, George Mitchell, guilty or not guilty?
Guilty.
On the second count, of stealing a gold and enamel necklet, the property of Diane Cunningham, do you find the accused, George Mitchell, guilty or not guilty?
Guilty.
On the third count, of stealing a gold-plated cigarette lighter from Richard Cunningham, do you find the accused, George Mitchell, guilty or not guilty?
Guilty.
There will be a sentence of 3 years on each count to run concurrently. Take him down.